Hey, everybody, what's up? Welcome back to Invest in Yourself. And today, we're talking all about passive income if you're just now joining us. So I wanted to bring up my good friend, our head coach. He travels all around the country, even around the world, teaching people real estate with us. And he's been to many different places. And he's our head coach, and he oversees our acquisitions department. He's got virtual assistants that work with him. He's buying houses himself. And please give a warm welcome to my good friend Randolph Cunningham. Woo! What's up?
Hey, man, how are you?
I'm excellent. How are you?
Doing well, doing well.
Great. Let me get my screen up here, and let's see what we're going to talk about today.
All right.
We're going to talk about some massive passive income on the buy side, okay?
All right.
So there are
a lot of – sorry, it's kind of confusing having to pass this back and forth. So there's a lot of different ways you can generate passive income in real estate. And we're going to talk about some of the main ones right here today. And in a few minutes, we're going to bring up Paul. And Paul is going to talk about how to market those properties to start generating that cash flow. But Randolph is going to be talking about the different types of properties, the different type of sources, and ways to structure deals. So Randolph, let's first start out and talk about the different types of acquisitions or properties get to create passive income.
Well, there's a number of different sources and places you can pick up these types of properties. I mean, obviously you can go to your local MLS. I mean, there are tons of properties there. Obviously they need to be being sold by the owner. I mean, the owner still owns it. It's not a bank-owned property. Of course, those properties typically don't work. unless you're going to do owner financing, buy it and sell it with owner financing. But you go to MLS, you can buy properties through HUD, use bandit signs. I mean, we pick up a lot of properties doing, you know, marketing our properties through bandit signs. Our signs get a lot of calls. Man, I'm going to tell you what, you could just, a lot of families and friends, just people knowing what you do, you have those kind of deals referred to. I've had a lot of deals referred to me just because people know what I do. Family members that may be over their head with their payments, maybe owe more than what the property is worth. Tired landlords, you know, and that's a really popular one. You know, someone who's just sick of tenants and toilets
and trash and termites.
There you go. So there's a number of different ways to find these different kinds of deals, and they're all over the place.
Yeah. Now, guys, there's a couple different ways that you can buy properties when you're wanting to create passive income. First way is cash. Now, if you're going to buy a property for cash, it's got to be a deep discount, right? If you're going to buy it for cash, the second way is terms, okay? I can pay your price if you give me terms, or I'll pay you my price, okay? If it's a cash price, all right? That's the two ways you need to look at it, because if you buy property for cash, now if I'm looking to create a passive income, somehow I got to come up with that cash if I don't have cash, right? So I got to come up with that cash and maybe borrow private money, not hard money, because that would be long-term. Hard money, short-term loan, but borrow private money or seller financing or whatnot. So if I'm buying a house on the MLS, HUD, MLS, bank-owned, REO, all that stuff, if I'm buying from an individual or a wholesaler and they need cash, I got to have a deal. I got to have a steal, right? So because if I'm paying you cash, I'm going to go somewhere else and get that cash, okay? Because I don't want to keep my money tied in it forever and ever, okay? Even if I do tie my money up in it, which I do, we have our own money tied up in it. There comes a point, I don't care how much money you got, you run out of money, okay? And we're at the point where we're doing more deals than we got money, okay? Where we're doing more deals than we got money. So, you know, that might be an opportunity for you, you know? You know, hey, if you're interested in maybe doing some private lending with us, that's another way you can create some passive income. We don't have a website or anything like that, but, you know, we got an email that people use, passive income at LarryGoins.com. And if you got some money and you're interested in investing it passively with us putting it to work for you, just shoot an email over to passiveincome@larrygoins.com and we'll see what we can work out. But the second thing is if you're not getting a great deal on a property, okay, which that's the only kind of deals we use whenever we're using other people's money, okay, if we're not getting those deep discounted deals, then what we're doing is terms from our seller. And that could involve several different ways of doing deals, buying them subject to seller financing, lease option, land contract. So what I want to do is I want to turn it back over to Randolph, since we only have one mic, and let Randolph share some things with you about the way we do this and the way we set up on the sell side when we're buying it. I should say on the buy side, us buying it, that we can set those up when we get terms.
One popular way that we like, especially because of our signs, get a lot of calls. We're dealing directly with the seller, and these typically have two scenarios where the seller still owns a mortgage, have a mortgage in place, and we get them to, in essence, be the bank for us, and in essence, a wraparound. So in essence, we'll keep their existing mortgage in place, and they agree to let us take over their payments, and in turn, we find someone. Let me give you an example. They have a payment of, let's just say, $800 a month.
Oh, tell them about that deal that Tom's working on right now. $160,000 balance, property's worth $200,000. Remember that deal?
$160,000. I think it's worth a little over $210,000, $215,000. The guy's payments on the house, I think, is $1,200.
TI.
Yeah, that's principal, interest, taxes, and insurance. Principal, interest, taxes, and insurance. So, I'll say that too fast, but that's right. But in that area, we can put that property, find somebody to take over. We take over those payments for $1,208. We find someone
subject to
that existing mortgage, and we find someone where they come in and buy the property and for $210,000, $215,000, we were looking at, and their payments be $1,578. I don't know why that number's sticking out of my mind. That was the number that's about what we're looking at. So, but there are a lot of deals like that where the homeowner's just fed up with the property. They just don't want to make the payments anymore, and they're willing to let us take over the property with that existing mortgage in place. So you have those scenarios, but then you have others where people don't.
Before you move on,
okay,
tell them about how much we're going to make up front. What are we going to give to the seller, and what are we going to collect from
the buyer? Okay. So
that's the biggest part.
Well, yeah. So
I chunk some money.
That's exactly right. Well, where we make our money is not just in the monthly cash flow, but it's the down that we get down from our buyer. See, our buyer is someone who's motivated. You think about this for a moment, okay? Who will buy a house from us? And we have a $160,000 mortgage in place. They're going to purchase it for $210,000 and $250,000. We're going to do the owner financing for them, and we're going to have them put down $20,000-$25,000. That'd be our down payment for this property. Okay. So we make our money on the front end. Also, we finance it for what we think of 5 or 10 years. More than what the seller is in it for. But in essence, the thing is that we're going to be in it making cash flow off this property for at least the length of time that our mortgage, that our buyer or our seller is in the property for. And we make a pretty big chunk on the front end. But again, that's in a scenario where there's still a mortgage in place.
Absolutely.
So, you know,
financing's in place.
That's exactly right. So, but there are also the scenarios, which these are also the best scenarios, where the person just owns the property free and clear. And that way you can get really creative, because now the person, you know, in that scenario falls in people who maybe have a property they inherited where they're sick of paying the taxes on it. Or, you know, maybe even they have family members that, you know, that are tied up in, and they're just sick of just dealing with the property with family. Okay. Or maybe in a scenario where there's a landlord, like we mentioned earlier, and they're just sick of renting the property. In either case, there's no mortgage in place. And that's the golden aspect about it. I mean, with Tom is dealing with one now. Tom is one of our acquisition managers. He's tearing it up. May is tearing it up. So
tell him about that free and clear house we were talking about this morning that he's got. $50,000, $80,000.
Yeah. So, the people who own the property, they tried to sell it for like $60,000, $65,000. Okay. They just reduced the price to like $50,000. Okay. Well, the comps in the area, okay, are rendering $80,000-$90,000 plus. Okay. So we're talking about going back to them, setting up a payment arrangement where we're paying them $500 a month, and give them the $60,000 that they originally wanted. Okay. They were going. They just dropped it to 50. We're going to pay them 60.
See, remember, I can give you your price.
That's right.
If you give me terms.
That's right. That's right. And so we set it up for 5 or 10 years, then turn around and sell that property with owner financing for $80,000-$90,000. And folks, this is a nice house.
Make a spread.
That's right. That's right. Cause, and the thing is, when you're doing your due diligence, and I don't know if I'm jumping the gun as I'm moving on. The thing is, what will that neighborhood, what will that area render? See, you have to, you still have to do the same due diligence as if you were buying the property to flip it. Because in essence, you don't want to try to resell the property with owner financing for more than what houses are selling for. You know?
That's right.
Also, too, you don't want the payments to be more than what the rental payments are in the area. So there's some due diligence that you really need to do on the front end in analyzing these deals to make sure that someone will see your advertisement, whether it's on Craigslist or Zillow or ride by your sign and, still, and be like, man, I can pay, I can make those payments and own the house. That's what the rents are going for. That's cheaper than rent, okay? So you really want to make sure you're doing the right due diligence when you're structuring these deals.
On the buy side.
On the buy side.
On the buy side. That's absolutely true. And that's very, very important. Now, where do you find these deals? Okay, you find. I got a mic. Now,
oh, okay.
Is this working? Do I have a mic?
I missed that.
Okay, good.
All right.
So it's because Paul was really slick getting up here. You couldn't even see him.
You're good.
So the flash. Anyway, so where are you going to find these deals? You can. There's many, many different places you can find these deals. Randall, give them a few examples of different scenarios and places and ways they can generate leads to find these deals with terms.
I mean, we mentioned a couple of them before, but you know, one of my, I'm telling you, bandit signs have worked wonders for us. Just putting out signs of, you know, we buy houses, and even our signs. Where we're selling houses. It mentions nothing about us buying houses. It talks a lot about us selling the house. We have a particular house that we're trying to market. Even those signs pull in a lot of those calls, people calling, hey, will you guys do owner financing? You know, it gets those kind of calls, but also people calling and say, hey, you guys are buying houses? And we're not even advertising to buy houses, okay? So they're calling off our sales signs. So, you know, signs work really well. You can even, these deals are all over Craigslist. I'm not sure if you guys hit your Craigslist a lot, but man, Craigslist is not just a great place to sell houses. It's a great place to find these deals.
That's right.
A lot of homeowners, you know, that's one of the easiest places for them to go and post their property. So you'll find a lot of motivated sellers there on Craigslist and your local paper.
Look for ads and run your own ads as
that's,
well.
Hey, that's exactly right. That's exactly right. The MLS. You know, even though the property is listed with the real estate agent, that doesn't mean that there's not a motivated seller behind that agent. And I, you know, I've talked to a lot of agents where the sellers, you know, they've said, man, you know what? This person just wanted to get from up under these payments, you know, and I tell you what, agents are good for that. You build a good relationship with an agent. You build a good relationship with an agent. They'll start to refer those kind of deals to you.
That's true. Absolutely. Randolph, is there anything else that you want to share with about analyzing a deal?
Yeah, I tell you what, I was always looking at the aspect of a newbie, okay? You know, I mean, yeah, there's a lot of seasoned guys out here, and I'm sure some of you guys are looking at this webinar, but my heart goes out to the newbie, because when you're just starting out, a lot of times, man, you don't have money. I mean, you don't have a lot of knowledge, not just a lot of knowledge, but sometimes you just don't have a lot of money either. So I'm all about what is some free resources available that you can utilize to analyze a deal and say, hey, this deal will work for owner financing. One site I love is Zillow. Okay. And I'm sure a lot of you've already heard of Zillow. Well, I don't, you know, be leery of Zillow. Okay. But it is good for some things like the Zestimate that they give you, the estimate of what the house is worth.
Forget it.
That's right. You don't ignore that. But here's what you do. Scroll down a little bit further and you're going to see recent homes sold. You click on those houses that are sold. And that'll give you a really good idea of what you can turn around and sell the house for. And I typically try to stay on the mid to bottom end of what the sales are. If I'm seeing sales from 70 to 95, friend, I want to be no more than around 75 on that house on the resale, 75 to 80. I want to be on the lower end. Okay. So not just Zillow for selling the property, but you can go to Rent-O-Meter, rentometer.com. You know, Rent-O-Meter is a good source to find out what the rents are in the area. And not just what the rents are, it really gives you a good idea of what kind of area is it. Is it a neighborhood where there are a lot of homeowners? Or is it a neighborhood that is infiltrated with a lot of rentals? That's going to be important when you're doing owner financing. Okay, is it somewhere where somebody want to buy a house? Typically, a house, a neighborhood full of homeowners, those neighborhoods are kept up a lot better. You know, not that all rental neighborhoods are bad. I'm not saying that at all. But it's traditionally, when people own their home, they take better care of the area. So another great site, Trulia. I use Trulia because Trulia gives me an idea of what the school district is like. Okay, that's a really good thing because think about it. You're talking about someone who's going to buy a house from you, put down a really large chunk of money. I mean, they may have children. Those things are going to be important to them. So you want to see what the school ratings are. Also, Trulia has a heat map far as the crime. You know, not that crime in the area is necessarily bad, but you want to have a good idea of what kind of crime is going on in the area and what types of crime. Okay, so those kind of things you want to look at on the front end when you're doing your due diligence on a property.
So how many murders in a neighborhood are too many?
One, maybe two. But yeah, so but very important, very important.
It is very important. So guys, the bottom line here in creating your passive income is make sure that if you're buying the property from a source that you're getting a great cash price, you got to have some private money lined up, okay, to be able to fund that deal, some long-term private money that the numbers will work. If you're buying on terms, okay, if you're buying on terms, in other words, you're buying it subject to there's an existing loan in place, or you're buying it with seller financing, or you're doing a lease option where you create a sandwich lease, or you're buying on land contract, then you go around and you structure your sell side to match this buy side. So number one, you make money on the front end. And number two, you make money every single month, right? So if we buy it subject to, we could turn around and say we put $2,000 down and we got an $800 a month payment. We could get $10,000 down and a $1,200 a month payment, right? So we're making the spread on that. And we just made the difference between the two and the 10. We put $8,000 in our pocket minus closing cost or whatever. So we could also sell that property on a lease option. We could sell it on a land contract as well. So we maintain the title and we get the tax benefits. Okay. And there's a lot you need to know about this to get started and to do it, because you gotta worry about the taxes, the insurance, who's paying those. Are you gonna escrow for it? Are you gonna collect it at the end of the year? You know, your insurance that's in place, the homeowner's insurance, you gotta be listed as lost payee. You put your seller as secondary insured on the property. There's a lot of different things you need to be aware of when you do this. So be careful, get some information, get some education out about it. And if you have some money you wanna put to work, you know, if you'd like for us to see if we got a deal you can put some money in, you know, send us an email over to passiveincome@larrydecohens.com. And we'll see, you know, kind of what you're looking for and see if there's something that matches up there. Who knows? So with that, Randolph, thank you so much, man. I really appreciate you. Randolph, the man, the legend, and the myth. And we'll be right back.